Everybody, and the Lord is good all the time, you know, He never changes. People change, but like the old song says, yesterday, today, and forever, Jesus is the same. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to His name. And we are here to serve the Lord and to come and have fellowship. Come and share what Jesus has given to us and what we are experiencing in the Lord. So we pray that we will bless you tonight. Hallelujah. You know, dear friends, it's wonderful that the Holy Spirit is so faithful and true. And the Lord confirms what He says. He confirms it to us over and over, and He's alive. And what is so wonderful is that we don't need to learn what to say. We don't need to go and rehearse what the Lord wants us to say. He puts it in our heart if Jesus lives in us. We don't need to go and study and then go and recite things or work things out. The worldly believers send people to a seminary, and there they get taught how to entertain the people. But if you follow Jesus Christ and you're a witness for Him, you get what you are going to say directly from Him. You cannot teach a person to be a witness for Jesus. You can teach them to be a salesman. And that is what so many churches are. They're just marketing organizations, and they're trying to draw people in and trying to build their empire. That is not what the kingdom of God is about. The kingdom of God is about Jesus. And the reality of Jesus in my life and in yours. You know, if Jesus is not real to us, then whatever we are speaking and whatever we are producing is just a show. Like so many church services, what they call it, a service. They service the people, they put up a show. Dear friends, the kingdom of God is not a show. The kingdom of God is about our relationship with Jesus and bringing others to Jesus so that they can also have that relationship with the Lord where they walk with Him daily. They experience Him daily. You see, salvation has been reduced to a quick sale, just a transaction. I was listening to a video today, and it was really, you know, to my dismay to listen to this thing, where this person says that, you know, world affairs are so urgent right now, and we can see it's end times, and people must just get, you know, they must just get salvation quickly. And the person was saying, say after me this prayer. And then once you've said this prayer, then you're good to go. And then if the rapture comes, you're going to heaven, and now you're saved. What a lie. What an utter lie, friends. The gospel of Jesus Christ is not about saying, repeating a sinner's prayer after somebody, and then now you're saved. It is about knowing Jesus for real. It's about repenting. Turning away from what you were, your futile existence, living for yourself and ignoring God, and then coming to Jesus saying, Lord, I want to know Thee for real, and getting to know Him for real, following Him. And Jesus must be real to us, friends, or else it's just a farce. It's just a game. Like with so many people, And you know, the Lord is so wonderful that when we come to Him, even when a person comes and he just says a simple prayer, the Lord takes him seriously. But a lot of people are not serious when they come to Jesus. And that is why they come short. I was just, this morning I was praying and the Lord was dealing with me about people that are backslidden. And that people backslide and then they just want to come back to the Lord and everything has got to be the same as it was before. But it doesn't work like that. Because if you go away from Jesus, then it becomes true what He said, that if the demon, if the evil spirit has gone out of a man and he goes over waterless places and then he comes back and he finds his house nicely clean and set in order, and then he fetches his friends and then they come. And then at the end of that person is worse than the beginning, because that person becomes a demon possessed. And ever so often I get emails from people who are backslidden and they got a terrible time trying to get back to Jesus, because they were delivered from alcoholism, drug addiction, and cigarettes, things. And the first time when they came to Jesus, it was just like that, and they were delivered and they were free. But then they went back and now they started smoking again. They're back on the alcohol or back on drugs. And now it's worse. Because one person says to me, I'm demon possessed. He says, I cannot help myself. More than one person, actually. I frequently get that people write me that letter. They say, I can't get back to the Lord. You see, the thing is that if we despise the grace of God and we turn away from the Lord after He has set us free, then next time He doesn't make it easy on us. And we will suffer. We've got to appreciate the freedom that the Lord has given us. And people don't appreciate that freedom. They think that they can use the freedom that the Lord gives them to indulge in sin. The Lord doesn't make us free so that we can go sin again. People want to be in good health. They want to be free so that they can go back to their sin and enjoy their sin better. And that is a big mistake. Because Jesus makes us free so that we can serve Him. When people are in bondage, when they are in addiction, they cannot do what they want to do because they are demon-possessed. And so a lot of believers are demon-possessed today. They cannot get free from the bondage of sin. Many of them have never repented. Many of them have never really come to Jesus and been free in the first place. But a lot of people were once free. And they went back to sin. They went back to the things of the world. And the end of those persons, those people, is worse than their beginning. We've got to take the Lord extremely seriously and not play around. We cannot afford to play around. We cannot afford to stop following Jesus. And now a lot of people believe this easy gospel story that they are saved, whereas none of us is saved yet. We are enrolled for the race, for the marathon. And we've got to run this marathon until the very end, but run it in such a way that we are not disqualified. We've got to run according to the rules. And we've got to endure until the end. Because if we drop out, or if we violate the rules, then we disqualify. Then we out of the race, out. People think they can just go back to the Lord every night and say, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry. The Lord is not even hearing their prayer. That prayer is absolutely useless. It doesn't go to the throne of God because they have no relationship with Jesus. You cannot have an off and on relationship with the Lord. You've got to follow Jesus all the time. All the time. That's not easy. Very few people do that. I see so many start well. And they will go on for a while and then they disappear. See how few people we are on here on Block TV. There are only very few disciples of the Lord. Very few. And you know, there are some people that start well and they serve the Lord with you for a while. They run along. And then you say something that hurts them. It's maybe their pet sin. Or it's their weakness. Instead of them repenting and saying, Lord, I need to get this evil out of my life, they start defending it. And then they go away. They get mad at you because you are speaking the truth. Well, the thing is that if we follow Jesus, then we've got to know it's a lonely road. And people will get mad at you. People got mad at Jesus. They got offended at what he said. Like the disciples said to the Lord, they said, Lord, did you know that the Pharisees, they were offended at what you said? He said to them, well, you know, he says, are you not also offended? You know, he says, blessed are those who are not offended at me. And friends, you know, if Jesus is in us, then we will offend people. We will offend the lukewarm people. We will offend our closest friends. Because people think that if they are friends with a pastor, then, you know, they can get away with sin. The pastor can cut them some slack, you know. There's no such thing. If you walk with Jesus, then you walk straight all the way. And he will straighten you out. That is what it is about. It is about bearing that cross every day, picking it up and following Jesus. And even if people reject you, and people stop liking you, and they stop greeting you, and you still go on, you follow Jesus. And that is why the clergy, the hired pastors, and preachers, why they've got a problem. Because as soon as they offend somebody, or they offend the rich guy in the church, then he runs away and he takes his money with him. And then they have a hard time to pay their bills. But you see, the thing is that they compromise themselves. They sell their souls to the devil and then they lose it all. If we follow the Lord, we will have hardship. We will be rejected. We will suffer rejection. We will suffer persecution. Right? We will have eternal life. You will lose business. You might lose promotion. But friends, in the end, what does it matter? If you lost a few dollars here and there, or you lost a friend here or there, or people don't smile at you anymore, what did you gain if you end up in hell? Nothing. You lost it all. You lost your soul. And that is what it is about. That is what people do not understand. You will pay a price for following Jesus, for obeying him. People will hate you. And if you're not willing to pay that price, then following Jesus is not for you. So, you know, people get disappointed and disheartened when they keep on witnessing and people run away from it. You see, and they see that not many people come along with it. We've been on this road for many years. And we've seen many people come and go. But you know, if people would, if they listen to the Lord, they will listen to us also. But if we speak the words of Jesus, then those words will be hard. They will be harsh on people. They will run away. But the main thing is that we've got to sow the seed. Because that seed that you sow, you don't see it grow. Sometimes, you know, you think that that person is, you totally put him off because you've given him the truth. He does run away, but the seed grows. The Lord makes it grow. And after some time, some of them come back and they say, you know, what you told me hurt me at the time, but it was the right medicine because it brought me to my senses. And I'm now following Jesus. How wonderful is that when, you know, when people tell you that they're following the Lord. In worldly terms, people want to, they want to create a following. They want to have a lot of people listening to them. They're talking about this unity story. You know, so there must be unity in the body of Christ. Let me tell you one thing. If you walk with Jesus, you're going to be walking on your own. And Jesus said he did not come to bring peace on the earth. He came to bring the sword. And he says even in one house, he will bring division between husband and a wife, and a father and a mother, daughter and mother-in-law. That's what Jesus will do. He says you will be hated by even your, by your own children. That is the sword that Jesus brought, and that he brings into our lives if we invite him in. You see, because the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. And when the word of God lives in us, when the words of Jesus are in us, then it cuts. And people will, they will avoid you. They will run away from you if they're not right with the Lord. Because they're running away from God. And the main thing is that we must not run away from the Lord. We must run to Jesus. And we must stay with Jesus. We must not be disheartened or distracted or put off when people criticize us and when they disagree with us. You see, this whole world is run on synergy, you know, and opinions. And, if we want to be pleasing to Jesus, then we're not worried about the opinions of other people, and whether they like us or don't like us. It doesn't matter. We love them, and we care for them, and we speak the words of the Lord. And because we know the fear of God, We speak the truth, and we bring them to Jesus. We're not bringing people unto ourselves. We're not building a ministry or a church or a following. We're making followers of Jesus. When a person has heard us, he must fall on his knees and cry out to Jesus, and he must follow Jesus. And he must be on his way with the Lord, not with us. He might just say, thank you, brother, for bringing me to the truth. But now I've got the truth. I'm following Jesus. That is what it is about. You know, I cringe when I see these popular preachers. You know, they're the big name preachers, and they got the big churches and these big ministries and empires. They're not busy with the Lord. They're busy with themselves. They're busy with their own empire. If we are bringing people to Jesus, then all that matters is Jesus. But, you know, these big names come to town. You know, they say, oh, the Pope is coming to town. Or such and such an evangelist. You've got these billboards painted all over. You know, such and such a person is coming to town. What about Jesus is coming to town? That's what it is about. is not about us. What are we? We are dust. And you see, all these big people, they got feet of clay. And not many years and they fall over. And they are exposed for what they are. They're just dust, you know. We're just men. We're just servants. It's not about us. It is about Jesus Christ. It's not man that's got to be glorified. We're not here to build something, build an empire, build a ministry or a church. These churches that they build, that's not the church of the Lord. That is the church of the organization. Jesus himself builds his own church. He calls unto himself his own children and they follow him. They don't follow people. They're not excited about, the pastor and the preacher. They're excited about the Lord. You know, I couldn't care if people don't speak to me. What really matters is Jesus speaking to me. Yeah? Are people worried about that the Lord is speaking to them? Is the Lord speaking to me today? Did he speak to me? Did I receive revelation from the Lord today? That is what is important. It's not important whether other people saw me or whether the pastor greeted you and said, "Oh, my brother, the Lord bless you." You know? People go to church so that the pastor can shake their hand and see them and say, "Oh, the Lord bless you." Friends, it's nice to have friends, but you know, it's to no avail. If we don't have a relationship with Jesus, you might feel less lonely. But the reason why people feel lonely is because they are not with the Lord. Jesus is not a reality to them. You know, Jesus is right here with me now. Right here. The question is, am I with him? Am I listening to him? His words I'm speaking here. Is it my mind, the things that I'm thinking up here? Or am I listening to the Lord, saying, "Lord, give me the words to say here, because I don't know what these people need to hear." You know, when we speak, our words must be like words of God. And if we are so full of ourselves that there is no space for Jesus, then we will just be blabbing about ourselves. It's me and my and what I've achieved and what I can do and what I've done in life. It's not about that. Yeah, I've done a lot of things, but I'll tell you what. The Lord has done a lot of things in my life. He's done many things in me and to me. And the Lord is real to me. And that is why I can talk about Jesus. I can talk about him until the sun comes out tomorrow morning. There's many things I've forgotten about what the Lord has done in my life. And this morning I was reminded, when I was backslidden and I came back to the Lord, it was uphill all the way, man. It wasn't easy. And you know, the Lord chastised me, man. He treated me rough. And the Lord scrubbed me. He didn't just say, "Hey, son, you're good to go, you know. Oh, it's good, you're back now, man. Come sit here." No. He scrubbed me and he did a harsh job on me, you know. And when you think it's over, he says, "No, there's something else there. What about this thing in your life?" I say, "Yes, Lord." You say, "Yeah, it's got to come out." Eh? And then, "What about that thing? You know, when is that coming out? Because if you want to follow me, you've got to stop. You've got to get rid of those friends, you know. And you can't do that anymore." So, you know, that's the way the Lord cleans us up. And he doesn't make it easy on us, especially if we've been backslidden. He's harsh on us because we've got to learn a lesson that, we must not take lightly the discipline and the love and the grace of the Lord. But all his ways are loving kindness. He's just good to us. God loves us. He cares for us. A child, sometimes they're looking for hiding. Because I was a child and I brought up children. And sometimes they're naughty just because they want to have a hiding, because once you've given him a good thrashing, then he knows, Dad cares for me, man. You know what, actually the old man's good, man. You know, I appreciate him and I know he loves me because he fixed me up. You see, so the Lord will fix us up. His hand will be heavy on us so that we can know that he cares for us. He will scrub us and he will form us, he will make us, he will discipline us, and he will hedge us in. He will show us the ropes, you see. People don't want the ropes. They don't want to be disciplined. And if we refuse discipline, then we are in danger of hellfire, you see. Because, you see, the Lord treats every child that he accepts. He treats them harshly, harshly. You see, our parents, they whipped us. My old man, he whipped me. And, and I whipped my sons, you know. And they remember it. They remember it. I've forgotten about many of the hidings I gave them. But they remind me. They say, Dad, you remember that in that day, you know. I say, well, what happened there? He says, hey, man, he says, you whipped me real good, man. And I say, well, I guess I shouldn't have done, shouldn't have smacked you that hard. He says, no, it was good. It was good. You know, and that is how we learn discipline. That is how we learn to fit into the household of God. And that is how we learn respect. What's wrong in this world today is people don't have respect. They don't have respect for God. They don't have respect for authority. And that's why they're criminals. You know, you get these youngsters, they take a gun to school and the police shoot them. They're criminals because they've never been disciplined. And friends, we've got to willfully submit ourselves to the discipline of the Lord. And we will feel His discipline. A lot of people grumble and they get bitter and twisted. There's no, you know, we must not get bitter when God handles us and when he fixes us up. We must be thankful. You know, there was a time when the Lord was treating me very harshly. And I felt very sorry for myself. I said, Lord, look at all these other people. They got a good time and I'm suffering, man. Say, Lord, you're just fencing me in and I can't move. And everything I try to do, you just give me a hard time. You know, but I'm so glad that the Lord didn't just wipe me off then. You know, but he made me understand that I need that discipline so that I can share in his holiness. And we've got to submit to the discipline of the Lord. Whatever comes our way, sometimes we need a bit of sickness, a bit of pain, you know, so that we can appreciate it, that other people have got pain, you know, because if you don't have pain, then you cannot feel sorry for another guy that has got pain, you know. The Lord knows how to treat us. And we've just got to submit, friends. You just got to wait on the Lord, trust Him, and follow Him every day. We belong to Him. A lot of people are stiff-necked, and they harden their hearts, and they harden their backs against the Lord. That is a very, very dangerous thing to do. Very dangerous. You know, when the Lord speaks to us, we've got to submit. And just be moldable. Yield to the Holy Spirit and say, yes, Lord, thy will be done. That's why we've got to pray the Lord's Prayer. Say, Lord, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. And we do everything just what the Lord wants us to do. He's our God. He's our Father. He's given us everything that we have. And He supplies in all our needs. He's a wonderful Father. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. You know, you see, there's a lot of anxiety going on in the world today. A lot of anxiety. You know why people are anxious? It's because they don't know the Lord. They don't have a Father. If you've known the hand of God, you don't get anxious. You know, my Father's in control. You know, my Father is mighty. Everything is in His hand. I got nothing to fear. Because He knows how to sort things out. He sort me out. And He knows how to sort everything out. I belong to Him. He cares for me. He looks after me. See, these people don't know the hand of God. They're anxious. They're running around. And they're trying to preserve themselves. They don't know God. What they don't know is that without Jesus, we can do nothing. You can go and dig yourself a hole in the ground, or you can build yourself a fortress, you know. You can hide somewhere in a mountain, or you won't run away from God. A lot of people are running away, you know. They say, now you've got to run, you've got to leave the country, you've got to do this, you've got to do that. I was saying today, you know, a lot of people say, yeah, they want to leave the USA. I say they must go to Johannesburg in South Africa. There they will get mugged the first day. So they're looking for somewhere, where to run. They say, run anywhere. You run anywhere and God will get you there. You know? God knows how to protect His children. There's nowhere that you can run from Him. A lot of people have got big mouths, you know, and they've got big plans. But it's because they don't know the living God. They don't fear Him. Friends, wherever Jesus is, there is safety. And He knows how to look after His children. But if His children are in sin, and they're not following Him, they got reason to worry. They got big reason to worry. You know, there's only one place to go and find peace and quiet and rest, and that is go on your knees, man. And go spend some time with Jesus. Say, Lord, please help me. Yes, the Lord has the words of eternal life. Where should we go? We got to run to Jesus. Even if you've done wrong, man, if you messed up, you go to the Lord. Say, Lord, I've messed up. He knows you've messed up. But if you try and hide your sin, you will not prosper. And if you repent of your sin, you go, you say, Lord, now I've made a big mistake. You know, King David, when the prophet came to him and he said to him that, you know, that he's a murderer and adulterer, what did he do? He humbled himself before God when he went in with Bathsheba and he killed Uriah. He didn't run away. No. He humbled himself before God in sackcloth and ashes, and he wept before the Lord for his sin. And God forgave him. That's the difference. You see, people are looking for an excuse for sin. David wasn't looking for an excuse for sin. He said, Lord, wash me and I will be whiter than snow. He said, purify me, cleanse me, cleanse my heart, purify me. You see, friends, we got to get all these evil things out of us. In us is nothing good. And we've got to lay ourselves bare before the Lord. Just come to the Lord as we are. And don't pretend. You know, I'm quite amazed. I see these people, they become evangelists, big evangelists, and they go to Africa and they go there with a suit. I was watching some pictures today. And when they become an evangelist or a preacher, they've got to put on a nice suit and they drive around with a 4x4, a Prado or something. It's not the way Jesus went, friends. It's not the way He went. We've got to be clothed in righteousness, not in hypocrisy, in nice clothing, and being smart, prosperous, and show the world that we are something. No, we are nothing. We take them to the Lord who can save. We've got to submit ourselves to God and be humble. And in our weakness, when I'm saying weakness, I'm not saying in our slackness, but in our utter helplessness, being humble before the Lord, His power is shown. Jesus says, blessed are those who know how dependent they are on God. Without Jesus, we can do nothing. I can do nothing without the Lord, friends. I've done a lot of things that I thought I was quite smart. But then the Lord made me know. that without me, you can do nothing. And I'm so thankful for that. Because now I put my focus on Jesus. I say, Lord, just show me the way. Whatever you want me to do, I want to do it. Friends, God's plans are the best. And God's ways are wonderful ways. We don't always understand them. And they make people scared. You know, when we look at God's ways, people say, it's impossible, you cannot do it. You cannot follow Jesus. Not in 2013, in 2030. So you can't do it. But friends, with Jesus all things are possible. Without Jesus, we can do absolutely nothing. And that is what it is about. It is about us making ourselves available to the Holy Spirit, coming to the Lord and denying ourselves. You know, when people talk about denying themselves, they just think of denying themselves pleasure, you know, and all the nice things in life. No, it's denying yourself also your own initiative, your own plans, your own resourcefulness, your own thoughts, your own knowledge. Everything that we've learned. To say, Lord, I know what I've learned. I know what's in my head. But that is not what matters. What matters is what is in my heart. Because that is what God is interested in. That which He puts into my spirit. His words that He puts in us. That is life and spirit. The words that we recite from our head. And that is not life, that kills. That is why Paul also said, he says, the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. You see, when the devil puts a scripture verse into your head, then it's death. A lot of people, they get their scripture from the flesh, you see. And they use the Bible to cut other people to pieces. You know, they break them down and they give them stories. They use the Bible as a sword to cut people, to kill them. But when the Spirit of God puts His words in our mouth, then it brings life. Then it brings people to Jesus. It brings them into the power of God that is able to save our souls. That is able to destroy fortresses. He puts wisdom into us. Wisdom that confounds the wise. You know, it's so wonderful when God gives you something to say. Because then you just know, it didn't come from me, it came from the Lord, and you know. It hits home and it punches right through the defenses of Satan. Because it's the power of the Holy Spirit, it's not us. It's not by power and it's not by might and it's not by our genius. It's by the Spirit of the living God. And if we're not led by the Spirit, our works are dead. A lot of people are doing dead works. You know, they think up a lot of stories and they write books. And a lot of people preach a lot of stuff from their own mind. But they're dead works. Flesh begots flesh. What is born of the flesh is flesh. So that message or that story comes out of your flesh, it's flesh. But if it comes from the Spirit of God, it brings life. And a tree is known by its fruit. And therefore we've got to ask the Lord to bear fruit through us. Say, Lord, put your words in us. Lord Jesus, please, let streams of living water flow through us. If the word is not coming from the Lord, I've got to shut up. Say, Lord, just purify me. Purify my heart, and my mouth, and my mind, and everything. So that the words of the Lord can flow through me. See, a lot of believers, they are dirty vessels. They will be watching television, and they will be watching pornography, and participating in the things of the world, and then they switch off, you see. They turn off, and then they want the Holy Spirit to go through them. It doesn't work like that. Either you're a vessel of honor for the kingdom of God, or you're a hypocrite and a liar, and you cannot produce anything good. What we produce, that shows what type of tree we are. Whether it's the Spirit of God that is flowing through us. Jesus said, I'm the true vine. My Father is the wine dresser. You are the branches. He says, without me you can do nothing. He says, if you do not abide in me, you cannot bear fruit. We've got to abide in Christ. That which we speak, that which we do, has got to come from the Holy Spirit of God. We've got to wait on the Lord and let the Holy Spirit work in us and through us to do His will. Not to please people, to please God. God knows my heart. He knows why I'm here. He knows why I'm sitting here, I'm talking. He knows it. Friends, if we're not doing it to please the Lord, we're wasting our time. If we're trying to do it to impress people and to make friends, then our hearts are wrong. And instead of the approval of God, we'll draw the judgment of God on us. And so many people, so many preachers will stand before the Lord and He will say to them, go away, I never knew you. Say, Lord, I preached, you know, I made videos, I put on YouTube and I did tracts and all that. Lord says, no, you did it for your glory. You didn't do it for me. You never listened to me. You were busy with your own thing. You thought you were smart. You see, God knows our hearts, friends. God knows why we do things. He knows what motivates us. He knows the intention of our heart. And we've got to be pure before the Lord. Humble ourselves before the Lord and say, Lord, your will be done. Lord, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. It's only when we submit ourselves to the Lord and do what He wants us to do that we can bear fruit. Otherwise, it's all in vain, friends. All in vain. Hallelujah. That's what the Lord laid on my heart for tonight. And may Jesus bless you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just humbly come before Thee and we submit to Thee, Lord. We are unworthy, Father, but we are called by Thee, Lord, for Thy kingdom. We want to be vessels of honor for Thee, Lord, to do Thy will. Lord, we are here to destroy the works of Satan. It's not by power, it's not by might, it's not by many numbers. It's by the power of the living God. Lord, that we come in Jesus' name against the powers of darkness. And we come and we destroy the works of Satan, Father. And we proclaim the kingdom of God. Say, Lord, let thy light shine in this world, Lord. And let us be shining lights that bring many to righteousness unto thee, Lord Jesus. Lord, let thy light be shown in this world. We are just here, Father, for thee, for thy kingdom. And Lord, after we've done what we had to do, we're still unworthy servants that only did what we had to do. We just praise and thank thee, Father, that we can be here tonight to speak, Lord, to speak into this whole world, into the universe, the kingdom of God, to declare that Jesus is King, is Lord, is Master. We praise Thee and we honor Thee, Lord Jesus. Be glorified, Lord. We praise Thy wonderful name, Lord. We thank Thee in Jesus' name. Amen.